Hello friends, today I am presenting you a talk by Dr. Anvay Mule. He is a very well known cardiac surgeon from Mumbai, attached to Sir Harkishan Das Reliance Hospital. He has performed many cardiac transplants and one of very well known cardiac surgeons. Friends, please subscribe to this channel because I will be presenting you many more interesting topics, medical topics in future also. Share this channel to your friends. Also give a thumbs up if you like this talk.
Survival rate at the age of 4 months. So by the end of the 1 year, almost everybody is, you know, the more than 30% mortality in all these patients. And that is where the heart transplant helps. As soon as you diagnose them, please do not wait, because 1 year mortality is very high in these patients. So natural history of the heart failure is goes like this. You see this patient in stage 1 and stage 2. And I think it is very important to catch this patient at your clinic, in your office, at stage 2 level. Follow them meticulously and religiously. And then when they go to the stage 3, it is end of it. Because you see this red line which is going down. So they go very fast downhill and they are deceased in no time. And then, so when they are in stage 3, stage 4, remember their downfall is very fast and very quick. Whatever medicines you give on earth, it is not going to save them. And then it may prolong with 6 months or 7 months. That's all it will do. And if you see the hospitalization, you see the dotted line. If you see this hospitalization, it goes on increasing, as I will explain to that in our NYHA classification here. So this is like NYHA classification for heart failure patients. That is what we call, it is called Intermax scoring system. Instead of NYHA class 1 to class 4, as it goes worsens the heart failure, here you go reverse way. So you start with the level 6, which is the bottom of your table. So that is where the patient is happy and walking and wounded, and he is wounded inside. The structural changes are happening in his heart, but he is still walking around, moving around, and nobody knows that he has got a heart failure. So this is walking wounded at level 6. Then they become housebound. They realize I cannot walk. They realize I'm getting shortness of breath. They realize I'm feeling weak and I'm getting palpitations or whatever. And they start staying at home. That is called the housebound. And then from there, whatever medicines you are given, all these 4 or 5 medicines which we discuss about, whatever you give, that doesn't work. Because as there is a swelling on their legs, as there is a swelling or the edema in their lungs, similarly, there is the edema in their stomach and all, that medicine doesn't get absorbed. So when they come to the hospital or casualty with shortness of breath, PND, can't sleep at night, and then we give the same LASIX injection, they feel good, they go home, again 4 days they come back, so they become frequent flyer. And this is a frequent flyer where I always say that this is the time when we must evaluate this patient, understand them if their heart transplant will benefit or there is something else we can do. And then if we don't do that, they become admitted to the hospital. They become stable but dependent on the inotropes, which are IV inotropes in the hospital. And then the mortality is almost weeks or few months and they don't survive faster. In this time, if we do not get the heart, because we have to register it and wait for the heart transplant, because it is not off the shelf, I can go and ask for his size of the heart or his blood group of the heart. It is not the scenario. So, and there is no live donors in a heart transplant. So we have to wait for cadaver. And in this COVID time, it is still worse. And then they suddenly, in front of us, they suddenly slide fast and crash and burn, that we can't do anything. So our waiting list mortality has increased in this COVID months because of waiting for an organ or waiting for a transplant. So we have seen almost, this is the old slide actually, we have seen almost more than 500 patients now in NYHA class 3 to 4 in last 5 years. The LV size is measured by EDD and BSA. So forget everything on this slide except these red letters. Left ventricular size more than 4 centimeter per meter square of diameter. This is the most important slide to take away for all of you. When we get an echo report, what we see is that LV ejection fraction. Oh, LVEF is 20%. Oh my God, finish. LVEF is 30%. Oh my God, this is finished. No, it is not the scenario. I'll tell you very recently, almost 8 months back, I had a patient referred for heart transplant. His LV ejection fraction was 15 to 20%. A young boy of 24 year old. And he was very restless because he was told to come for a heart transplant. So when they come to me with the idea of heart transplant, they are really, really shaky. So I took his blood pressure and I found the blood pressure was 170 by 110. Now, was it a high white collar hypertension? Was it because he came to my clinic with hypertension? So I told him to wait and relax. And I said, you are not a candidate for the heart transplant. So I told him that don't worry about it. Go and have a coffee and then come back after half an hour. I checked after half an hour, blood pressure of 170 by 110. I waited for another half an hour. I told him to some gossip we did some chit-chatting and everything apart from his health. And still I checked the blood pressure 170 by 110. So I saw suspicion with a patient of 23-year-old with hypertension of 170 with ejection fraction of 15 to 20%. But in that the LVIDD, these red letters, was less than 4 cm/m². And that was my catch point. So I told send him for ultrasonography. And ultrasonography showed he had got adrenal adenoma. Because of it, there was hypertension. Because of it, there was diastolic dysfunction. His adrenal adenoma was out by laparoscopy. He is hale and hearty. Ejection fraction has bounced back to 45%. And he is no more required heart transplant. And more than 100 transplants we had done. I think I'm more proud, or I think I learned more by not doing the heart transplant in such patients. And that is what I feel this slide is very, very important. So we just don't look at the ejection fraction on the echo. We see the valve, we see other things. But most importantly, we see his LVIDD, which before I started heart transplant, as a surgeon, I must confess that I never saw it. Honestly, I never saw it. So then we see these four types of different types of the clinical subset. And in these patients, the warm and dry patients of the heart failure, they are perfect. We can manage them medically as much as you want. Warm but wet, diuretics is the treatment, either oral or IV, but diuretics. Cold and wet, inotropes and diuretics, that is bad. And the worst prognosis is when they are cold and dry. And that is, inotropes also don't work. They are severely vasoconstricted, and that is the stage where we have to think and which are to support the mechanical circuit support or any other further treatment is required. So early listing is very, very important and it's very, very indicated in our scenario at least. So if I look at the US database, and they have got list of 5,000 patients for waiting for a heart transplant. So from where they come? So they are picked up at very early stage. They are listed. But when the time comes, they take 2 years to get their heart. In spite, 2,500 heart transplants are being done in every year in USA. The list is 5,000, and their time to get their heart comes after 2 years. So why they list so early? Because they follow them up very crucially, very crudely, and they don't allow it to happen. I'll explain to that in the next slide. So these are the some criteria. What we do. And what we do for these patients before we list them, that will this patient benefit from heart transplant? Will that body accept this new heart in him, or it will reject? What is the possibility? That is the studies what we do. Thirdly, will this new heart will accept the changes in the lungs which has happened and the lung pressure has gone up? Will that heart accept? Because we have seen that heart, the new heart, what comes here is not used to the high pulmonary pressure or high pulmonary wedge pressure. While because of the heart failure, the pulmonary pressures, the lung pressures have increased 3 times, 4 times in this recipient's heart. And that new heart doesn't tolerate it and it fails in front of us. So all these studies are being done of rejection, of possibility, with the acceptance, will it benefit? What is the risk involved? What are the other organs doing? I know the heart is gone. I know the heart is in dustbin. So from here onwards, we try to protect these lungs, liver, and kidney. I am not concentrating on the heart. Remember, I am not concentrating on heart. Once I know that patient is heart failure patient, ejection fraction of these end diastolic measurements have gone more than 4 cm², his heart is gone. So he is alive, but I want to keep his lungs, kidneys, liver, and other organs in good shape. That is very important, and that is why I say, plea for early referral. Please, early referral to the expert center. They may not admit them compulsorily. So patient still can be followed up by you, but then with the different measurements and different criteria. So what are these patients when they come to us, we decide for a heart transplant. When they are in severe heart failure, because of any reason, whether it is dilated cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, residual cardiomyopathy, valvular cardiomyopathy, ischemic cardiomyopathy, idiopathic cardiomyopathy, whatever the reason, when the heart is failing, my pump has weakened and gone down, I have to change it. Now, the most important indication for a heart transplant is severe heart failure. Second is debilitated refractory angina. We have done angioplasties, we have done bypasses, we have done all sort of laser surgery, whatever you name it, we have done it. In spite of that, patient has angina. There is no heart failure here. Remember, his LVIDD is good. His ejection fraction may be 30-40%, but still refractory angina is another indication. I have not yet seen in India the patient with refractory angina, but it is very common in Europe and in USA. So the third is ventricular arrhythmias, where the vein is intractable. When my AICD has failed, when my medications has failed, my different sympathectomy, all other kinds of treatment has failed, and the patient, in spite of devices, drugs, and alternative surgical therapies, in spite of that ventricular arrhythmia, that is another indication for heart transplant. So heart transplant remains the ultimate treatment for the heart failure. And we have done almost 100, more than 120. So this is our total number per year. 2015 was, we started in 2015, August, we started this program in Mumbai and then mortality. The 2016, because 2015 and 2016 was the year when we started getting all end, means all burnt out heart failure, very, very sick, refractory, in Intermax level score 2 or 3, that high, not 6 or 4 or 5, Intermax level 2 or 1, that high. And then our mortality also reflected was year high. After that, again, we started selecting the patients, and 2017, the mortality year, which is in purple, has come down, 2018 and 2019. So this is the early mortality of first 30 days. So our, on an average, our mortality of the first 30 days is around 80, survival is 82%, mortality is around 18%. That is with international standard. And here comes the late mortality of the first years. So again, the 2016 and 2017, the late mortality is higher, because most of the patients here we operated were from very poor family. And then I realized, and nowadays I'll tell my patient, from 2018, I'm telling my patients that, listen, I'll beg, borrow, steal money for your heart transplant. I will take a loan for you for a heart transplant. But you promise me that after the heart transplant, for whole of your life, we will continue taking the medicines or immunosuppressions, which will cost around 12 to 13,000 rupees per month for rest of your life. And if you cannot, then it is very wasting that, it is like kind of wasting that organ. Can I do heart transplant? I can do. But then will his body reject it? Then there is no treatment or no cure for it. And it is very, very pathetic and sad that when I realize that some of the patients, they stop taking the medicines here. If you go to Bangalore, Karnataka, if you go to Tamil Nadu, if you go to Hyderabad, the government is sponsoring 13,000 rupees per month for first 5 years to this patient for immunosuppression, and 15 lakh rupees for heart transplant. The government is sponsoring in these 3 states. In Maharashtra, it is not yet, but then we can't vouch for that, and we cannot tell about that also. But this is the scenario of the late mortality, and the some challenges what we face in this transplant program is that as I explained to you, our recipient should be worthy of this. That is, liver, kidney, and lungs should be in a good condition to accept that heart and to tolerate one transplant. Otherwise, they'll end up with heart and liver, heart and kidney transplant, and then the problems becomes more and more, as you can understand. And the donor should be worthy. Means donor should be of the same blood group, same size, the heart mass. That is very important. And he should not be non-smoker and this and that. So there are a lot of criteria. His pumping power should be very good. And all these things are taken into consideration before we call our recipient, that there is a call from government that they have allocated this heart to you and this heart is good. So do come. And it takes really, really time for it. Now, this is the time when I always say that if you register early and if you are doing well, and if your medicines are helping you, when you get a call, you can always say, no, I'm not yet ready, I don't want it. But your number remains high in your waiting list. And that is very important. So you can always deny. It is not compulsory that you are registered means you have to undergo transplant. No, I'll come to that again. So then we are starting this patient with Mildrinone at home. So to get a patient to admit it and and decompensate their lungs and liver and kidney and improve their blood supply by injection Mildrinone, you see, they have to get admitted in the hospital. But I can't keep them admitted for a month or 2 months or 3 months, because Mildrinone is a costly medicine, and admission in a hospital in ICU, again, they finish 5-6 lakhs rupees every month, and there is no end to it for Mildrinone. So we started this, we admit for 2-3 days, see that he tolerates the Mildrinone, there is no anaphylaxis because of Mildrinone, and send them home on this chemo pump on Mildrinone. They come after 5-6 days, they reload their pump and they go home. And then lastly is a mechanical circulatory support. Again, it's a costly thing, and it is very, very costly. But if the patient crashes in front of us, there is no way we have to put. So if we register them, if we evaluate them at early stage in the program, this Mildrinone at home and mechanical circuitry is not required. And the cost of the transplant and everything comes down tremendously. So this is the scenario. There is a long waiting list of the transplant, but there are no donors. In India, there are no donors. And in USA and in Europe, in spite of the donors, 2,500 donors every year. In spite of that, their waiting list is 5,000. And here we have got a waiting list of 200 or so, and we are getting donors around 50 or 100 in a year. So that's the scenario at the moment. So it has increased. It is getting better. And as we started the program in Mumbai, that time it was 0.05 per million donation rate of our society or our community, which is better now, is 0.8 per million. So if it comes 1 per million by our population, every year we can get 1,200 hearts. Can you beat it? 1,200 hearts just by 1 per million. If we get a donation rate. So by this mechanical circulatory support, what has happened is that the waiting list mortality survival has become better. The waiting list, the transplant mortality has decreased, and that is the biggest advantage of the mechanical circulatory support. Out of these 115 patients, almost 35 patients who have to put mechanical circulatory support, and those who got transplanted after getting mechanical circulatory support, all are alive, 100% survival. But those who could not get the heart, I cannot give the mechanical circulatory support lifelong. There are permanent mechanical circulatory support, but they cost 1 crore. That is too high a cost. And then it becomes a destination therapy. Those who get this, they don't want to get a transplantation done. So we have got different 4 types of mechanical circulatory support. All of you know IABP. Now everybody is knowing ECMO because of COVID and all. And third is temporary LVAD. And fourth is the permanent LVAD. So permanent LVAD is one destination therapy. But all these three of them, in the first three of them, are temporary ones. And they need to be followed by the transplant. So when we consider for support, so when there is a preoperatively, when there is a high pulmonary vascular resistance, when there is a renal failure, secondary to the cardiac failure, refractory heart failure, and intractable arrhythmias, we put this support. During operation to support the right ventricle or the left ventricle, during the transplant, we use this. And third is postoperatively, when the right ventricle rejection happens or dysfunction happens, to support that right ventricle, we put this RVAD. So which we decide, ECMO or LVAD, which one will decide? So when we have got patient when patient has got ECPR, that means we are giving the CPR at the same time we are putting the ECMO. That is the fastest thing we can do. So ECMO can be put very fast. It can be done in casualty. It can be done at some peripheral center, or it can be done in ICU also. I don't require an operation theater for it or general anesthesia for it. I can do it very fast. If RV is impaired and if the lungs are bad, ECMO is the indication for mechanical circulatory support. The second is, if you come down, then when it is the plan, high LVDP is there. With ECMO, there is a pulmonary edema, and if the lungs are good, then temporary LVAD. So that is another one. But we nowadays prefer the Centrimag to the ECMO machine, because we can convert them from ECMO to LVAD, LVAD to ECMO anytime when we want. There are some examples. So this is a patient who had an arrest with the general physician in his office, And then actually he was telling that he's getting palpitation and very shortness of breath. So he was writing on a paper about go and do an 2D echo. And while 2D echo, he got arrested. So he wheeled him to the hospital. He got in the hospital and casualty. From casualty, he was a little stable. He was taken up for echo. And then there again, he arrested. So when they were arrested, they put an intra-aortic balloon pump, stabilized him, and then called us. That time, I said, no, on IIBP, he will not survive. He will require an ECMO to transfer. That is the safest way to transfer. Then we converted him in ECMO in the same hospital and then transfer him for temporary LVAD. So he was converted to temporary LVAD because his left ventricle was a problem, not a right ventricle. ECMO is good for right ventricle, not for the left ventricle. So temporary LVAD to LVDP and PVR, they came down. He got in 5 or 7 days, he got heart transplant and he's healthy and happy and fine. So there's a bridge to bridge and bridge to transplant. So this is another example of a young boy who was a pediatrician. He went to the pediatrician for breathlessness and he arrested there. He was intubated, massaged and resuscitated. 2-3 days he was there, thought he will come back, but he did not. And so he was sent back to us for viral myocarditis. We put him on LVAD. He's watching and playing WhatsApp or whatever on his cell phone when he's attached to the LVAD. He's extubated, he's extubified. And then after 7 days or 10 days, we realized that his heart is better now, heart is improved. And so we removed the LVAD and he was discharged. He did not undergo transplant. So the Centrimac is a temporary LVAD. This is a patient who in front of us went into the renal failure and his preoperative pulmonary vascular resistance was 8. If the pulmonary vascular resistance is 8 or more than 5, he is not good for transplant because that new heart will struggle against that pulmonary vascular resistance and will collapse there in front of us. So when he had when he was admitted with us to evaluation, in front of us his kidney stopped functioning, no urine output. So we immediately put him on LVAD for 42 days, this man. So this is the patient here. Here the patient is walking on LVAD in the ICU. You see, he's walking here on LVAD in ICU. And this is after the transplant. Here on the right side, he has got a ECMO machine here. You can see the ECMO machine here. And he is on the LVAD machine. And 42 days he was on LVAD machine. He started pouring urine and he was waiting for a heart. When he got a heart from Chandigarh, and he got transplanted and he is going home and he's followed up after 4 years. He's doing fantastic. He's doing really well, really well. So this is a bridge to the transplant. And this is a patient from Surat and he didn't want a transplant because of financial reason and he wanted to go home and in front of us, he crashed. We massaged him, we put him, took him to the operation theater because it happened in hospital, took him to the operation theater. He was on a waiting list, crashed in the hospital. He put an LVAD, he's walking on this LVAD machine, you see here. So he can walk and for 30 days, he was on this LVAD. When he got a heart transplant, he got a transplant from Surat only, he got a heart and he was transplanted there. So this is bridge to the transplant again. So then temporary RVAD, right ventricle assist device. LVAD is left ventricle RVAD. So we had put two temporary right ventricle assist device. One was after the HeartMate 3, that is permanent LVAD. And second was after the heart transplant. Both were successfully weaned off and successfully discharged. This is the Centrimac machine. This is a temporary LVAD. So with this, you can't go home, you see. With this, you cannot go home. All this is attached to the patient and he's in the ICU. When this is small size, we can implant this LVAD in the heart. So here from the left ventricle, it goes into the aorta. This one cable, electric cable, which comes out here and it is in your carrier bag. This console and controller is there and patient can walk around, move around a normal life and he can go around everywhere. So the HeartMate 2 or the transplant or the permanent LVAD is a bridge to the transplantation, but it can become destination therapy because cost is very high. So to conclude back, so my heart is gone. My patient's heart is gone. So keep lungs, liver, kidney in good condition. That is very, very important. Very, very important. Mildenol, and that is no fault of lungs, liver, kidney. It is because of the bad pump, they are getting damaged slowly. And we have to stop them somewhere and do the transplant at the right time That is the best advantage and benefit to the patient. We can do any time, but then benefit is lost if it is done at a wrong time. The mechanical circuitry support with its side effects and limitations gives the best result, and we prefer the Centrimac to the ECMO. And sometimes I feel that live problem is better than dead certainty, and when we use the mechanical circuitry support in this patient. To summarize, the main three indications in India I found and our part of the world is cardiomyopathy, either hypertrophic, ischemic, dilated, idiopathic, whichever way. The second is ischemic hearts, and third is congenital hearts, where we get a heart isomerized lung and we get a heart-lung transplant is to be done. So dilated cardiomyopathy is the when we diagnose it, we do 2D echo, pulmonary vascular resistance and renal functions, and panel of reactive antibodies, whether his body will accept the heart or not, and then proceed for a transplant. In restrictive, pulmonary vascular resistance and PRA is done, and as soon as possible, transplant. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, they have a very short course of life. Their pulmonary vascular resistance goes very high, and then we can't do anything. And they do very, very bad if they are prolonged or neglected. So in short, there's a science, there is a socioeconomic problems, and the transplant, we have to interlink with each other. And that is why to understand the economics and social reason, I plea for early workup, and that is very, very important. This is, I think, is a, and thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. It was a wonderful session. So I invite all the delegates, if they have any questions, please feel free to ask, sir. To registry for heart donors or heart?
No, not in India.
So how does one apply? How does one wait? Where is that list?
I think that is a very good question. Pertaining to our land, our law of our land says that we have to have consent from the relatives next to the kin. Now, even if I plea for organ, even if I write in my will, even if I have signed and I have got some 10, 15 as I'm a donor, my card. But at that time, if my family refused to, because when I land up that stage, I'm brain dead. I'm not conscious. And then there is my vote or my thing. I'm dead. So only the, so if I can convince my next to kin and tell him that this is my last wish, please donate my organs. If my death is because of the brain death, and please go ahead. This is my last, then and then only it is used. For to take them, this decision also becomes easy.
Correct.
Abroad what happens is that, see, there are two ways of opt-in and opt-out society. What is opt-in is that I have to declare that I am in the system of organ donation. Okay. And what is the opt-out system is that you have to declare that I'm not an organ donor and I have to be out of organ donation. So the Spain, Sweden, Canada, UK now, and Italy, and these are the some countries where there is the opt-out system. Means by national law, you are a donor, but when you become 18-year-old and go for a driving license, then you have to say that would you like to be an organ donor or out of it. So if you say that I am out of organ donation, I do not wish to donate my organ, my name comes in a newspaper on a TV channel, and if after 20 or 30 years, if I require liver, kidney or heart, I will not get it. Right?
Okay.
In India, in America or majority of the countries, it is opt-in system. And when is the opt-in system? That is, I declare that I want to be organ donor. But if the family doesn't want it, they will not sign it, then it is useless. So where there is an opt-in system also, there my driving license has got written on there, I'm an organ donor. So if I go as a casualty, suppose I get a head injury, a rotary accident, I go to the hospital in USA or in Australia, and if they see my driving license and there is an organ donor, the whole nation is alerted. That is why you asked me the question. Is there a national registry for donors? There is no national registry for donors.
So I was just always curious whether you refer to this line of people or, you know, you are like looking at registers or something. All right. Thank you, sir. Any questions?
Sir, I have a question. So what is the contraindication for heart transplant?
The contraindication, yeah, it's a good question. So contraindication for the heart transplant is usually take is the age. Second is severe pulmonary vascular resistance. Third is PRA antibodies. What is PRA antibodies? That panel of reactive antibodies. So we study them before. So we send the blood of a patient and match it with samples of around 50 to 100 blood samples. And we check whether that blood sample has got antibodies against that or not. Suppose panel of reactive antibodies is more than 10%, then the chance that my body will reject this new heart or kidney, whatever it is very high. And then there are certain methods we do or we don't do the heart transplant. There are certain therapies what we give to do a heart transplant if it is required. Now, the fourth is malignancy. Suppose patient has got malignancy which are spread and the life expectancy of that is going to be less than the heart transplant, then there is no advantage of doing comorbidities. Like you have got liver involvement, lung involvement and kidney involvement, all the three involvements. And then to get a donor who will donate you liver also, kidney also and heart also, that becomes difficult and is busy difficult. So then mechanical circuitry support in them is a better option.
Sir, another question. You said that the patient is on immunosuppressants for a long period of time, right? My question is, is he prone to infections as well because of the immunosuppressants, or is it specifically?
Yes, very interesting question. I'm smiling is because of the COVID. Now,
okay.
We always tell the patient from the day when I see my patient for a heart transplant, we always counsel them. That two, three things the patient mere ko puchta hai ki mujhe kya karna hai aur family what they should do. They should do avoid infection, start wearing mask, which now they don't mind it because the whole world is using the mask, but they are very shy of using the mask. So start using the mask, avoid eating outside because it is not cooked food is okay, but uncooked food outside you can have vada pav, but vada is okay, hot boiled vada is okay, but not pav or chutney with it, or which is uncooked food. Salad, avoid it outside. At home you can have it. High diet of proteins diet. So most importantly is that because I tell them that you are on immunosuppression, so chance of you getting, I am suppressing your immunity, I am suppressing your police system, so chance of you getting infection is very high. So please, please avoid all these things. Somebody has got fever, somebody, please stay away from it. And this is from day of first visit of me to the heart, our heart failure clinic, till the first or 2 years of transplant. He has to follow them. But now, interestingly, what we have observed is that those patients who are HIV, those patients who have heart transplant, liver transplant, kidney transplant, who are on these immunosuppressions, they get COVID because COVID comes from air. Nobody can stop getting COVID, right? But the morbidity, mortality and complications in them is very less. Very less. Now, 10 patients or 8 patients of mine who got a COVID and after the heart transplant, all of them have recovered fantastically. No HIV patient has found to have COVID morbidity. If you do the swab, they will get positive. You can't stop that. It is from air. Right, but getting to the morbidity mortality level, they're less. So then but the patients who are kidney CKD patients, chronic dialysis patients, kidney failure patients, those who are on dialysis and not undergone transplant or not on immunosuppression, their mortality is very high.
There is the cyclone storm, right, sir?
So maybe the COVID is using our immunity to kill us.
Yeah. Against
yes, I'm not sure, but sort of like that, it is something is happening.
Very interesting.
Sir, survival rate of after the heart transplant amongst ladies and gents, I mean the males and females, is the same?
Yes, it is the same. Survival rate is same.
Achha. No hormonal.
No. So what your question was probably is that if I get a female heart and put it to a male,
yes,
they have seen that mortality is little higher internationally. Mm-hmm. But it is not because of hormone. I think it is of the cardiac mass.
Yes.
The cardiac mass for a body surface area the cardiac mass is smaller or something, so it is something to do. But the patient with the male patient donor, male donor to a female recipient, his mortality is not bad.
Females are very accommodative.
Very accommodative. They are the book God has given them to accommodate everyone. I agree with you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. I believe we don't have any questions, but thank